Good morning, students. How are you? Hope you are all fine. In the previous video, we have learned the poem "The Tables Turned" by William Wordsworth. Hope you have understood that poem in a clear manner. And in this video, I am going to teach you poem number 3, "The Builders." Poem number 3, "The Builders," written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. So before going into the poem in detail, so what is the meaning of builders? So generally, builders construct buildings. The people who construct the building is called builders in a simple thing. But according to the poet's point of view, it has a separate meaning. According to Longfellow, it means the builders refers to the entire human beings, the entire human beings, human race. Okay, let's move on to the about the poet. So the name of the poet is Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. Here, just be careful with the name Wordsworth. In the previous poem, "The Tables Turned," the name of the poet is William Wordsworth, W-O-R-D-S, W-O-R-D-S. But in this right poet's name, it is different, W-A-D-S. So be careful while writing these two words. So here we need to write W-A-D-S. So Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. So that is the name of the poet. So let's see the important things regarding our poet. He was one of the greatest American poets. One of the greatest American poet belongs to USA. And he belongs to 19th century. He belongs to 19th century. So most of the poems we have, poets belong to British. But here, in the second year, and he is the one among the American writers. So he belongs to 19th century. And he was a poet, educator, traveler, and a linguist, and a romantic. Educator means scholar. Traveler, who is fond of traveling, who traveled many countries in the world, and a linguist who have thorough knowledge on languages, and a romantic. Here the word romantic, we already discussed in the previous poem, "Tables Turned." So romantic poet mean a poet who takes nature as the subject, who appreciates nature in their poems. So such poets are called romantic poets. So we can say he is also a versatile genius. And then the last point, the poetry, his poetry was rooted in American life and history. American life and history. So most of the poets belongs to other countries rather than British. Other countries rather than British try to imitate or follow the British poets because they have a mark, earlier mark in English literature. British poets dominated the English literature. We see most of their names. But Americans are completely different. Particularly this guy, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, show his regionalism. He don't want to imitate the, he don't want to follow the British poets. He creates his own style of writing poems. And he is said to be the poet who do not follow the British poets. He has a unique style of way writing poems. So that's why his poetry was rooted in American life and history. And these are the important things we need to learn about the poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. And let's see his famous poems. There are three famous poems written by him. First one is Paul Revere's Ride, and the second one is The Song of Hiawatha, and the third one is Evangeline. So these are the most popular poems written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. And now see about the poem, what he says in the poem briefly. Let's discuss the poem in a brief manner. The present poem is a simple metaphor where human life is compared to a building and human beings are builders. So there is a comparison. So as I said at the beginning of the poem, as the title suggests, we the human beings are builders. So here we should know what is the word metaphor refers to. It is a figure of speech in literature, as we have alankaras in Telugu. It is called figures of speech in English. So one of the figures of speech is metaphor. It is similar to a simile. It is like a simile but have a different feature. Here, metaphor refers, there is a relation between the poet compares two unrelated things without using the words like and as. If the poet use a comparison by using like and as, such figures of speech is called simile. But here metaphor is, there is no, the content is the same, but the difference is there is no linking words like and as. The comparison is direct. So that is the meaning of metaphor. So here the object building is compared with human life, and human beings are compared as builders. So here is the meaning. And the poem is about how we make every day and how we create our own future. It is an inspirational poem which we can apply across the globe, It suggests every human being in the world. The poem is about how we make every day, how we use time in a fruitful manner, and how we create our own future. So we can make it brief as, the poem advises the human beings, spending time in a proper way decides the future that you want to build. So this is about the poem in a brief manner. And let's see the stanzas in the poem. It is a poem of 9 stanzas. Every stanza consists of 4 lines that are called quatrain in literary language. So how many stanzas are there? There are 9 stanzas. The poem The Builders is a poem of 9 stanzas, and each stanza has a quatrain. So let's discuss the stanzas in detail. Okay? ఫ్లాషెస్ మళ్ళీ. సో లెట్స్ బిగిన్ ద పోయమ్ అండ్ లెట్స్ లెర్న్ ద పోయమ్ ఇన్ డీటెయిల్. వాట్ ఐ సెట్, ద పోయమ్ ఈజ్ ఆఫ్ 8 స్టాంజర్స్ అండ్ ఈచ్ స్టాంజర్ హ్యాస్ ఏ క్వాట్రైన్. ద క్వాట్రైన్ మీన్స్ ఎవ్రీ 4 లైన్స్ ఈజ్ కాల్డ్ ఏ క్వాట్రైన్ ఇన్ లిటరీ లాంగ్వేజ్. సో లెట్స్ బిగిన్ ద పోయమ్ బై సీయింగ్ ద first stanza. Here, the first stanza, the writer points out all the architects of fate working in these walls of time. Some with the massive and great, some with the ornaments of rhyme, some with the ornaments of rhyme. So these are the four lines. The poet compares, as I said, the poem is a simple metaphor where the human beings or the builders and the building, what we build is our future. What we build is our future. And see the first line, all the architects of fate. Here the word all refers to we, the human beings. We are all. It is a metaphor. The architects of fate, architects means who plans, who draw a plan for the building and who build a building. So those guys are called architects. Here the architects are human beings. We are the architects of our fate. Here fate, in the sense, there is a meaning of destination, but here we need to understand fate equals to future. So through the first line we can understand we are all the responsible for our future. We are all the builders of our own future. That is what your writer wants to say. And see the second line, working in these walls of time. How we are building our future, how we are constructing our future, how we are shaping our future in these walls of time. Here he advises us to use the time in a proper way. By utilizing the time, we are shaping our future, we are building our future. And see the third line, some with massive, some great, some with massive and great. So some people do great things, some people do small things. So whether the thing, whether it is a big or small, whether it is a huge or small, doesn't matter. So every deed has its own result and has its an effect. So here some people do huge things to build their future, but some people tried little to build future. And some with ornaments of rhyme, some with ornaments of rhyme. So here ornaments, in the sense, we can understand a jewelry in a common meaning, but here the ornaments of rhyme means, so rhyme is generally we see in poems. So the poets add extra things. That means what we gives the example as metaphor, the figures of speech, we can take them as an example of ornament. So some people do things on the surface, they don't have a deeper impact. So different people do different things to build their future. Some people do huge things, some people do little things, some they just show off only. So with the accents we can build our future by utilizing the time. So that is the meaning of the first stanza. And let's enter the second one. Nothing useless or low. Here the writer uses the words, put the words in a different order. This is called anastrophe in literature. Anastrophe means juggling of words, put the words in a disordered manner. Generally the structure of the sentence in English is in this way: subject, verb, object. Subject, verb, object. Here take the example, I like potatoes. I is the subject, Like is the verb. The word potatoes, the noun potatoes, is object. But in anastrophe, the writer uses in a reverse manner. He uses the object first, and then verb, and then subject. See, useless is low. Here, nothing is useless. Nothing useless is written here. Okay, the order is reversed. Okay, whatever it may be, that is a literary thing we have. According to the poet, every action has its own value. Everything is useful. Everything is useful. So no action is useless. That means the deed, the action, the contribution done by the human beings, nothing is valueless. Everything is important. And here, this particular line shows the positive attitude. That means optimistic way of thinking here. Here the line shows the optimistic nature of the poet. So that's why he treats every deed that contributes to build our future, build the future of a country or a state, is useful, is worthful. And see the next one. Everything in its place is best. Everything in its place is best. So when we put the things in a proper place, and we can see them in the best way. So that's why every action, every contribution, what we provide for the future, is important, is valuable according to the poet. So that's why he said everything in its place is best. Every human being has a valuable place in this world. And see the third one. And what seems but idle show. And some actions seems useless. If, for example, if you are doing a project, if you are doing a thing with the cooperation of many people, and in that a team, some people are there, they just pretend to work, but they're not working really. So such kind of deeds we see as an idle show. But here the writer takes such kind of deeds also have a deeper impact. This shows the poet's positive way of thinking, optimistic way of thinking. And what seems but idle show strengthens and supports the rest. So every huge action should be supported by small actions. With that cooperation, with that coordination, we can fill a task, we can complete a task. So whether it is a great action, whether it is a small action, everything matters. Everything matters. So nothing is useless. Everything is best in its place. So that's why the writer suggests us to improve such kind of attitude while we building our future. Right, come to the third stanza. In the third stanza, for the structure that we raise, time is with materials filled, our today's and at yesterday's, or the blocks with which we build, So such a beautiful, inspiring poem here it is. For the structure that we raise. So we are, as the poet said, the future is compared, is like a building. We are building a different structure, So whatever the shape it may be, it depends on the decisions what we take. It depends on the time how we utilize it. Okay, the structure that we raise, for the structure that we raise, time is with materials filled. Time is with materials filled. So see it. The particular lines means here the poet points out that anything that we want to build worthful takes time. It requires hard work, energy. It requires a hard work and energy. So everything that will be worthful takes time. So that is what this particular sentence means. Here, what I discussed earlier, anastrophe. What is that? Anastrophe. It is a figure of speech where the structure of a sentence is reversed. In this particular figures of speech, the object comes first and the verb next and the subject comes at the end. See this one, time is with materials filled. Actually, the word filled should be here after is. The time is filled with materials, but the object materials comes before the verb. So this type of structure is called anastrophe. Okay, whatever it may be, the particular lines indicates anything that builds worthwhile, anything that builds worthwhile will take time, will take time. Our today's and yesterday's are the blocks that we build. So if we take the complete meaning of this particular stanza, we can tell it in a brief manner. The future, what we are building, what we are architecting, what we are shaping, is happened by using the time of the old and time of the present, time of the past and time of the present. Here the writer talks about the time. He is repeating the word time in every stanza. So time is the materials filled. What are the materials filled with the time? Is our today's and yesterday's, our today's and yesterday's, our past days and the present days. So here the poet suggested, don't forget the past, don't forget the platform where you come from. Just focus on utilizing time in a proper way. So all the blocks that what, that with which we build. So this is the materials, these are the materials, like past and the present, the time of past and the time of present we are using in building our future. So remember, and these two lines are given as second annotation at the end of the lesson, and this is also one of the important annotations you need to learn. So there is a first annotation in the first stanza. Here mark the first two lines, all the architects of fate working in these walls of time, and this is the first annotation and this one is the second annotation. Please mark these sentences in your textbook and come to the fourth stanza. Truly shape and fashion these, leave no yawning gaps between. Think not, because no man sees, such things will remain unseen, such things will remain unseen. So in this particular stanza, he is continuing his advice to the human beings, how we build our future. So what kind of character a human being need while building his future? By using the time in a proper way, and truly shape and fashion these, leave no yawning gaps between. So forget, don't forget about the past. Here he used the word yawning gaps. Actually the word yawning indicates when we are tired and bored, we just open our mouth in a wide way. That is the action we call yawning. That is the action we call yawning. Here, we thought that some people do not contribute properly, and that worthless actions we treated as gaps. But leave it, think not. So here the poet suggests, don't think in that way, because no man sees, such things will remain unseen. No man sees, such things will remain unseen. That these two lines refers, every action of human being is worthful. It has a deeper impact. Don't think whether it is worthful or worthless. It is worthy or unworthy, no matter. Sometimes the worthless actions, what you feel, may have a deeper impact, may have a support in building the future. And those things are unseen. Those things are unseen, what we treat them as yawning gaps. So don't think in a negative manner. So he advises us not to think in a optimistic way. Optimistic means look at the things in a darker side. So this is the way. And come to the next stanza. In the elder days means the days in the past, in olden days of art. Here the writer uses the word art. So everyone is an artist who is building his future in the whatever way he wants. Builders wrought. Here use the wrought. Here the word wrought has a special meaning. It doesn't have a present sense. It is generally used in only past tense. That means that something that brings the change, something that is caused to something happen. That is caused something to happen. The people, our fathers and forefathers who lived in the olden days have contributed to shape our future. So we need to consider those people's actions also. We need to take them worthy actions. We do not forget the past. They will also help us to shape our future. So that's why the writer called the people in the olden days as artists. Of course, he used his art, and we can treat them as an artists. Builders wrought with greatest care. So in olden days, the people used great skills to shape the future. So that's why he used the greatest care, with careful thing. Each minute and unseen part, for the gods see everywhere. So each minute and unseen part. So every action done by the past, the people who lived in the past, is worthful. For the gods sees everywhere. Here the poet refers, God doesn't see whether it is a worthful action or worthless action, unworthy action. He just blessed the human beings. But here we understand people who contributed the great deeds in shaping our future must be remembered. So we should not forget the contributions made by the people who belong to the olden days should not be forgotten. We just treat them as a worthful actions. So that is the meaning this particular stanza refers. And come to the next stanza. Let's do work as well. Both the unseen and the seen. Make the house where God may dwell beautiful, entire and clean. Beautiful, entire and clean. Let's do work as well. Here, through this stanza, the writer suggests us to work, to do your work incessantly. That means continuously, without judging of the other's work. It's a waste of time. Don't judge the other's matters. You don't have any right to. Because every work that is done by a human being has a particular effect. Because the actions what we did affects our later lives. If you, for example, if you did good things in the present time, these good things will help your children to shape a better future. That is the thing what has been done by our forefathers. That means he refers as a past, elders, elder days. You see, that's why he suggests, let's do our work as well. Let us perform our duty, what is given by the God, in a proper manner, by building a good character. We need some qualities to shape our future. The qualities that are required to establish a great character is integrity, honesty, resilience, perseverance. Perseverance, resilience, honesty, and integrity, these are the qualities a human being requires to shape his future. We need to develop these kind of qualities. So make the house where God may dwell. So that's a be careful while shaping your future. So here the writer asks us to treat our future like a God, like a house. The house where God may dwell. Here, dwell, the word dwell refers live, reside. Whenever we use the God, we just give a holy meaning. It becomes sacred. So that's why treat the future as a sacred one. So fill up the blocks by using the time in a proper way. This is what. And make the house where a God may dwell beautiful, entire and clean. So what kind of house we should build? Beautiful, entire and clean. It should be hygienic and it should be completed and it should be beautiful. How can we get this kind of such a huge, such a beautiful structure? The structure what we takes as our future. By adapting the qualities what I mentioned. So this is the way the writer suggests us to plan our future by using the time in a proper manner. And need not to forget, we should not forget the contributions made by the olden days, because they worked hard. They worked worthful to provide us, to shape our, to provide us a better future. So we have to build our future by using those contributions, and we need to give importance to those contributions. And these are the stanzas we need to learn. So these are the six stanzas. Here, I again suggest you the last two lines of the sixth stanza, the first two lines of the sixth stanza. Let's do work as well, both the seen and the unseen. It is also annotation number 3. These two lines mark as annotation number 3. So both the unseen and the seen. Some people's actions are visible and some people's actions are invisible. Because some people work behind the curtain. Behind the curtain means those people do not appear physically, but they just contribute what is needed. So such actions are unseen. So here the unseen and the seen, have the effect, have a deeper effect in shaping our future. So that is what is said through this beautiful stanza. So let's see the other stanzas. Okay, I hope you have a clear idea till this one. Okay.
So let's begin the seventh stanza. I am reading for the convenience of you. Realms are lies incomplete, standing in these walls of time. Broken stage ways, where the feet stumble as they seek to climb. I am reading again. See, realms are lies incomplete, standing in these walls of time. Here the poet points out, if we do not use the time properly, the building, if you are not using a quality less material in constructing a house, that house may not erect for long period. So in that way, while building our future, we must be careful, otherwise our lives will be incomplete, there will be no proper meaning to our lives. So that is what here the poets want to suggest. So standing in these walls of time, broken stairways, where the feet stumble. If we develop bad tendencies, the bad qualities, our future will be disturbed. That's why he advises it. We should be careful. The human beings must be careful while shaping their future. So as we discussed earlier, we need some good qualities, a great character to build a stronger, to build a better future. So here the writer suggests us what the things we should not do. If we do worthless things, if we develop the bad tendencies, the future will be disturbed. And that is the thing he wants to suggest through these lines. See, broken stairways. The blocks we may have gaps in blocks, the blocks, the rooms will make gap splits. And where the feet stumble, can we stand firm in a, that means strong, less building, powerless building? No, we can't. Our feet may stumble. Stumble means shakes. Here, with the bad characteristic features, we may not shape our future in a better manner. So that's why he advises us, he keep on advising to be careful, to develop some good qualities to build our future as we seek to climb. When we want to reach the next stage, that means the position where we want to be, the steps may not appear because the steps are weakened. The steps, that means the qualities we have adapted. If the qualities are good, the future will be good. If the qualities are bad, it is like a building that is built with the low quality material. With the low quality material, the building may not stand for long. So that's why he suggests you have to develop good qualities like integrity, perseverance. The word perseverance means determination in spite of difficulties. Though we are facing some difficulties while reaching a goal, we just bear it. We should bear it. That forbearance, the quality of forbearance is called perseverance. So such kind of patience, such kind of perseverance we need while shaping our future, because we want to build a great future, we want to build a beautiful future. So everything that is a big thing that requires so much of time, so much of hard work. Like that, if you want to build a beautiful future, you need these kind of qualities. Otherwise, your building will may fall down in a very short time. So that's why he wants us to be careful through this time. And come to the 8th one. Build today, then strong and sure, with a firm and ample base, and ascending and secure, shall tomorrow find its place. Build today. We have to use the time in your program. We have to value every minute, every second what we are spending matters. It shows effect on our future needs. If you use the time in a fruitful manner, you may plan your future in a better way. If you spend time in a lazy way, you may face inconvenience, you may face difficulties, you may not build a proper structure, that means proper future. So that's the build today. Take care of today itself. The strong and sure. You have to make it sure the action what you are doing is right. First believe in yourself. First believe in yourself. With a firm and ample base. So here the writer suggested, what kind of basement should we have? Ample and firm. Ample and firm means strong, powerful, mighty, unbreakable. Such kind of basement we need. So basement means here the writer suggests the qualities, good character that we require to shape a better future. And ascending and secure, with those qualities we can grow ascending from low level to high level. And secure, our future will be secure. Shall tomorrow find its place? Here the writer gives in-depth meaning. The future generations will not be affected by our deeds. We just think over, we just think about the future generation also. Because what the deeds we did now, what the deeds we are doing now, will affect the later lives. So that's why the writer said, our forefathers and fathers have contributed, has provided us such a good qualities to us. By using those qualities, we are living. They leave us, they make this earth as a beautiful place without disturbing them. For ours, for our happiness, for our future, like that, we should also do proper actions. We should also use time properly by reminding them our future generation, that means your children. So the qualities what we are showing now show the way to the next generation. So that is what he said, shall tomorrow find its place? The next generation will be free, should be followed very freely without any confusion. So that's why the deeds what we are doing today or now will affect us, will affect future lives. So that's why be careful by building our future. Be careful by taking decisions. So this is what the writer said in his second stanza. And see the last one. In the concluding stanza, in the final stanza, what the writer said. Here the writer says, thus alone can we attain to those steps where the eye sees the world as one vast plane and one boundless reach of the sky. Finally, the poet says, thus alone, by adapting those qualities, by taking the suggestions what he has given till now, we can attain, we can reach a stage, we can reach a position to those turrets. Here, the position. Here, the writer combats the position with turrets. So, what is the meaning of turrets? The turret means it is a shape of tower. It is like a tower shape that is generally put on the top of a building, especially on a castle. Especially on a castle. So turret means a tower shaped like structure generally constructed on the top of a castle, fort, a huge building. So here turret indicates the highest position. Turret indicates highest position and where the eye sees the world. From here, we should change our perspective. What kind of perspective we need? What kind of angle we should adapt to look at the world? See, where the eye sees the world as one vast plane. If you adapt a positive mindset, you should not see any differences among the human beings. All will be appear equal before us. When will we have such kind of quality, and you have such kind of character only, when we have such kind of character only, we will get that such kind of way we look at the world. The way we look at the world, the perspective must be like this. How perspective will be like this? We see the entire world as a vast plane. Here plane is equal. We should not see any differences among human beings. And don't judge the other's matters. Because the writer said, every action, whether it is a small thing or a huge thing, so affects the latter. So that's why when we change our perspective, when we see the world in the same way, then only we reach the turrets. Turret means the highest position, the peak stage, and one boundless reach of the sky. And this is the ultimate thing. The boundless reach of the sky means then only we reach the position where the limit is. So such kind of people he wants to see, such kind of future he wants us to build. So thus the poet gives a beautiful message to us in building our future. So that's why my dear students, take the advice and apply in your real life. So take the example, if you are using the time in a proper manner, so your future will be better. Of course, we are in the tough times, we have plenty of time to enjoy. But and this kind of time also, we need to plan our studies. So that's why here the management, the college is providing you these kind of facilities for your convenience. Because with all these facilities, you may not stop your learning. It will also help to learn the things better. So this is what the poet says through this poem. So there are two paragraph questions given at the end of the lessons, and we have 4 annotations in this poem. And I'm telling you, the first 2 lines of the last candidate is given as 4th annotation. Thus alone can be named to those devils. And this is the 4th annotation that is given at the end of the lesson. So thus we have 4 annotations and 2 questions regarding this particular poem. Hope you understand the meaning of the poem in a clear manner. Just go through the summary of the poem that is given after the lesson, and you may have a clear idea then. Hope you understand well. So thank you for watching.